Good evening and welcome to this youthful edition of Catechesis. We begin this session in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Gloom and despair seems to have become the chorus and the lyrics of our days. And so I thought this evening we could spend some time on the ability to ignite hope and accept the peace of the risen Christ. Over 100 years ago, in a Scottish seaside inn, a group of fishermen were relaxing after a long day at sea. After a serving maid was walking past the fisherman's table with a pot of tea, one of them made a sweeping gesture to describe the size of the fish he claimed to have caught. His hand collided with the teapot and sent it crashing against the whitewashed wall, where its contents left an irregular brown splotch. Standing nearby, the innkeeper surveyed the damage. He seemed to have been upset. "This stain will never come out," he said. "The whole wall will have to be repainted." "Perhaps not," was the reply. All eyes turned to the stranger who had spoken a yell of hope that goes against reason and logic. "What do you mean?" asked the innkeeper. The stranger replied, "Let me work with the stain." Standing up from this table in the corner, he said, "If my work meets your approval, you won't need to repaint the wall." The stranger picked up a box and went to the wall. Opening the box, he withdrew pencils, brushes, and some glass jars of linseed oil and pigment. He began to sketch lines around the stain and filled in here and there dabs of color and swashes of shading. Soon a picture began to emerge. The random splashes of tea had been turned into an image of a stag with a magnificent rack of antlers. At the bottom of the picture, the man inscribed his signature. Then he paid for his meal and left. The innkeeper was stunned when he examined the wall. That was a mesmerizing work of art. It elevated the entire whitewashed wall. As he leapt forward and knelt, he had a magnifying view of the signature inscribed. The innkeeper was stunned when he examined the wall. "Do you know who that man was?" he said in amazement. "The signature reads E.H. Landseer." Indeed, they had been visited by the well-known painter of wildlife, Sir Edwin Landseer. How much more God wants to take the stains, the sins, the disappointments of our lives. Haven't we heard that advertisement jingle, "Daag acche hote hain"? Not merely does God want to erase the stains, but he wishes to transcend them into work of miraculous beauty and reality. Easter then is God's great protest against everything that is defeating and death itself. This is what the Gospels narrate. May I draw our attention to a Gospel passage that talks about the resurrection. I read the Gospel passage from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 to 10. "Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been moved from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.' Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He began to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. The Gospel of the Lord. My dear young people, the disciples were all drained with the drama of the crucifixion. They had caved into their own tombs. They were cocooned with fear of being killed. And this led them to almost quarantine themselves. The cross was always a symbol of shame, a messy affair in the age of Jesus's time. But Jesus converts the mess of his age into a message of hope for all ages to come. The cross will become the chair of God, and these two planks of wood nailed together will become the signature of our Savior. Caught in the misery of losing Jesus, we hear Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb. What unfolds then seems unbelievable, because ours is a God of the impossible. The life of our Savior is bracketed with two great impossibilities, the virgin womb and the empty tomb. Mary runs to inform Peter and the other disciples, and each of them, we're told, outruns the other. It is not yet a Christian marathon till they will discover that he who was dead is now alive. The tomb was only a temporary residence, but it is not just the empty tomb. More importantly, the apparition narratives where the risen Lord is encountered. The resurrection of Jesus is the joyful flag flown high on the Christian textbook. In another gospel passage, we hear the question, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Question to Mary. Probably many of us as young people would not even be asked this, since a good many of us have stopped seeking itself. Pope Francis calls Easter the feast of tombstones rolled away. He adds, human history does not end before a tombstone, because on that Easter morning, it encounters the living stone, the risen Jesus. Often some of us turn out to be Leviticus Christians, stuck in the past, stuck in despair, burdened with rules and rituals. A good many of us even drop dead, metaphorically, if I may say, spiritually, emotionally, relationally, and with young people, I might add, additionally, addictionally. Too many of us show up on Easter as an attendance mark, but don't really intend to show up after it. This deserves our action, because Easter is a verb. Easter, more than a noun, raises volume of being a verb. The English Renan Martin defines verb as an action thing. Easter then isn't meant to be a record of a faithful history, but it is to provoke the history of today's faithful. It is to provoke the faithful of today's history to rise up. To believe in the power of the resurrection is to allow God to work and collaborate with him. In the midst of accepting and living our crucifixion Fridays, we are to believe in the Easter Sundays to come. The hope of the resurrection stirs us on. A true disciple then is not one who is in the clinic of a tomb psychology, but one who lives in the sanctuary of a hope theology. When Christ joins you in finishing the story, the outcome is a masterpiece. And we are not talking here merely of an artist, Sir Edwin Landseer, but the divine author of creation itself. In God's grammar, Easter fits better as a verb than a noun. We're all called, therefore, to believe in the power of hope and to ignite hope. We have a little quote from the UCAT that I like to bring to your attention. I'm quoting 105. The disciples who before had lost all hope came to believe in Jesus' resurrection because they saw him in a way different after his death. They spoke with him and experienced him as being alive. The Easter events that took place in Jerusalem in the year 30 are not a made-up story. So hope is an important ingredient of our lives. And I wish to weave within this hope our openness as young people to accept the gift of peace which the risen Lord offers us. We read the Gospel of John chapter 20 earlier. A few verses later in John chapter 20 verse 19, Jesus once again will appear to the disciples and he begins his customary greeting by saying, "Peace be with you. Shalom." And then he shows him his hands and his side. And then yet again in verse 21, when the disciples rejoiced and believed, he repeats again the greeting, "Peace be with you. Shalom." Jesus repeats this gift twice. This is the gift that the risen Lord offers us. Some months ago, as I was walking in the street, I saw a gloomy young man walking on the streets. As he walked closer, one could read on his shirt a very flashy calligraphy of bold capitalized phrase. It read, "Do not disturb." And then as he got closer, you knew that there was a finer print below the bolder print. In bold, "Do not disturb." Below, "Already married." The peace that this man requires can be tackled on another day. Today, however, we reflect on a higher resolution of peace. Peace that is an inner disposition that allows one's realities to be disturbed and yet holds on to the balance of life with a smile. The author Bruce Larson, in his book Believe and Belong, shares how he tried to help a New York executive with his control needs. This seems to be a major problem for all of us. We somehow seem to have believed that we have discovered everything and that science and technology is within our control. And this is evident that in these days of the lockdown, we feel that how can we live without so many things in our circles of control? I recently saw a meme that had Mr. Bean with his characteristic eyes popping out. And the subtitles read, "If a 10 rupee soap can kill the coronavirus, why are the scientists taking so long?" It seems that we have lost our sense of patience. This young executive also had control issues. And Larson realized that no amount of management theories sometimes are capable of changing our paradigms in life. So he took the young executive to the Rockefeller Center in New York. And there in front of the center was the exhibit of the famous Atlas. Atlas, who is shown carrying the world on his shoulders. Undoubtedly a piece of art, so well chiseled and sculpted and mesmerizing to the eye. But a closer look revealed that Atlas is straining and struggling to carry the world on his shoulders. Larson then took the executive across the street to St. Patrick's Cathedral. And there behind the altar, a statue of the boy Jesus, also carrying the world, represented by a small orb in his hand. But unlike Atlas, Jesus isn't straining or struggling. He's radiating peace. Then it dawned on the executive. He had a choice: continue to carry the world and struggle like Atlas, or give control of the world, including his world, to God and know peace like Jesus. To carry the weight of the world on your shoulders may be an expression linked to Atlas and figures of speech, and we can all be weighed by real burdens. But if we dare to cross streets to the other side, we will meet up with Christ, who lightens us with a gift of peace. Not really an exchange offer. The Christian then carries the burdens of life without losing peace. Pope Francis comments, "This is the only way we can understand how many saints lived their final moments without losing their peace, to the point that witnesses would say they walked to the Colosseum to their martyrdom like guests to a wedding. The peace of Jesus cannot be obtained through human means, like going to a doctor or taking anti-anxiety drugs. This comes from the peace of Christ, the Holy Spirit within us, and that brings with it strength. Peace is not an exchange offer, because conditions apply." I'd like to bring to your attention an Italian fashion photographer by the name of Michael Belk. I think recently he has made even faith fashionable and in vogue. In one of his works of photography, he displays a traditional piece of a scripture passage where the banquet is thrown, and it shows us Jesus having this lovely party with young people. But he weaves within this picture a modern understanding and interpretation by bringing young people in the frame. He wants to bring the text of the scriptures with the context of today, so that the scriptures will speak to us today and now. I'm sure we can take a look at this picture. And the title of this piece is interesting. Whenever we are invited to a wedding feast or an important occasion, we receive an invite card with four alphabets in bold italicized dots in between. They're called RSVP. The expression does not really come from the English language. Schools of hospitality and etiquette tell us that RSVP originates as a French expression. Répondez-vous plaît. Pardon my Googled French pronunciation. But the idea here is that Jesus invites all of us to the feast. All of us are invited to the Eucharist. It comes with RSVP, which means the invitation has been extended. Will you please be kind enough to respond to the invitation? The choice is given to each of us to accept the invitation of the Eucharist. The document of sacred liturgy, Sacrosanctum Concilium, tells us that the Eucharist is the source and summit of Christian life and worship. The choice is ours whether we want to accept the offer or reject it. Very often, the words RSVP is also tagged with another phrase, regrets only. I'm only hoping that a few years later, some of us may not have to look back on our lives, and the only phrase that lingers in our mind would be regrets only. So grab the invitation of Jesus, ignite hope, and welcome the gift of peace. We take a moment of silence as we compose ourselves to pray.
Our Lord Jesus said to Saint Faustina, "Before I come as the just judge, I am coming first as the King of Mercy." The mercy of God is one of the most revealing themes in the entire Bible. The whole of salvation history is walking through the door of God's love and mercy. Moses gets a glimpse of God's mercy. God tells Moses, I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. David surrendered to God's mercy. Israel's great psalmist King David would cast himself utterly on the mercy of God as he would sing his great psalm of confession. Have mercy on me, God, in your kindness. Psalm 51. Jeremiah wept for God's mercy. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. St. Paul marveled at God's mercy. He attributes his ministry to God's mercy. In the Gospels, the most prominent request made of Jesus, we see by the blind Bartimaeus, the Canaanite woman, boy with a demon, two blind men, the 10 lepers, is, have mercy on me. Today, let us come before Jesus and plead for mercy, because Jesus is the mercy of God made human. We begin this Divine Mercy Chaplet with the hymn, God of Mercy and Compassion.
God of mercy and compassion, look with pity upon me. Father, let me call thee Father, 'tis thy child returns to thee. Jesus, Lord, I ask for mercy, lend me not implore and beg. All my sins I now detest them, never will I sin again.
Opening prayer altogether. You expired, Jesus, but the source of life gushed forth for souls, and the ocean of mercy opened up for the whole world. O fount of life, unfathomable divine mercy, envelop the whole world and empty yourself out upon us. We pray this prayer 3 times together. O blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fount of mercy for us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fount of mercy for us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fount of mercy for us, I trust in you. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
We pray the I Believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We have our first decade. During this decade, we pray in a very special way for the Universal Church, for our Pope, Archbishop, auxiliary bishops, bishops and priests, that in this moment of crisis, they may steer the church in the path of righteousness. Together, eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
The second decade, we pray in a special way for the end of this pandemic. We pray especially for the healthcare workers, police personnel, all those in line of duty who are risking their own lives for you and for me. We pray for also the doctors doing research that effective cure may be found. Together, eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
The third decade, we pray specially for the dying, that they will make their peace with God, that God may grant them a merciful judgment. Together, eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
The fourth decade, we pray specially for all souls in purgatory. Together, eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world. whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
The last decade, we pray especially for the youth who are the present of the church. As we pray for them, we also place our own needs before our merciful Jesus. Together, eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Concluding prayer together. Eternal God, your mercy is endless and your treasury of compassion is inexhaustible. Look with kindness upon us and increase your mercy within us, so that in difficult moments we may not despair, nor become despondent, but may, with great confidence, submit ourselves to your holy will, which is love and mercy itself. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh, the love of my Lord is the essence. Thank you.